welcome. Thanks to Lyons Township High School, and in particular, Mr. Bob Foskett and his talented crew, allowing the production of another program honoring our local veterans. Hello, my name is Richard Flatley. I'm the National Aide de Camp and past commander for the VFW Memorial Post 10778, Western Springs, Illinois. Our panel of distinguished World War II veterans will share with us their personal experiences during the war. Our moderator for today's program is Dr. Henry Allan, who also served in World War II as a machine gunner, having seen action in the Philippines and in New Guinea, and was among the first American troops into Japan after the surrender. Dr. Allan received his PhD from the University of Chicago. He is an ordained minister of the Unitarian Church and dean at Moraine Valley Community College, Palos Hills, Illinois, and is also the author of H Hour Plus 3, the saga of the United States Army Amphibious Engineers in the Pacific during World War II. I would like to turn the program over to Dr. Allan at this time.
It's my pleasure to be with four veterans of World War II. Each one of these men have stories that I think you're going to find very interesting. Some of it is very tragic, some of it's kind of funny, and there's a lot in between. I'd like to introduce our first speaker, and you're going to forget the names anyhow if I just go around, so we'll just take it one at a time. And the first speaker on my left is Ken Kading. And Ken has some stories for us to hear. When we were rehearsing, Ken, somebody made some connection between Private Ryan, in one sense. Was some of the things that you did sort of reminded them of that very interesting movie. So what we'd like to do is to have you talk a little bit about your, and if you want to do it chronologically, if you want to do it from the time that you came into service until the time that you left, we could do that. Just give us kind of an overview, and then we're going to move to the rest of these guys, and then we'll come back and do some other questions. Yeah. So it's yours now.
Okay. I'm a native of LaGrange Park. I've lived there my whole life. And my family has grown up there. And I graduated from Lyons Township High School in 1943, June. Went into the service in October of 1943. Was taking basic training in Camp Fannin, Texas, which is near Tyler, Texas, for 17 weeks, and then shipped out of there. This is all in 1943 and part of 1944. From Camp Fannin, came home for a little bit and then went to Fort Meade, Maryland, and was assigned to be shipped. To be our port, but it was bombed that night as we were coming in. So we had to go to Cardiff. And then from there we went to a relocation center, reassignment center more or less, where all the troops were coming into England, thousands of them, just thousands upon thousands of American and Canadian troops.
Were you in one of the cities, or were you in?
No, we got off the docks at Cardiff, and then mm-hmm. we're by truck, you know. Mm. We went to this reassignment camp, and from there we were assigned to different divisions, different units. Some were in engineers. Some were went in. Nobody went at the Air Corps, but most of the people went to either engineers, infantry, artillery, tanks. They were all replacement people that were coming over to fill in.
Did you have any choice in which?
No.
No, you were just told
just
what
had
to do.
Fortunately, I was assigned to the 1st Infantry Division, which is was an experienced infantry division from, it had been in Africa, one of the first ones to land in Africa, and then in Sicily, and then we're back in England to prepare for the invasion of Europe. And I felt real fortunate to be assigned to a real veteran unit. I had good leadership, good officers, good cadre, the whole bunch. It was just a real good outfit. And this was infantry. The bulk of the 1st Division were line infantry, riflemen, machine gunners, mortarmen, and that. And I was assigned to the 26th Infantry Regiment, which was in Swanage, England, which is just south. It's on the Channel Coast, where the whole division and several others were assigned all the way from, in the southern part of England, from Southampton all the way down to Plymouth. Mm-hmm. And that was in March, and it took March, April, May. We had intensive training there prior to the invasion, and then we were shipped out of Swanage a week or so before June 6th was the invasion date. Well, nobody knew, of course, when it was going to be, and we were about 2 weeks shipped down to Plymouth, England, and there from there we went to took training there in sand tables and things like that, where no, it was going to be in France, and we weren't specific at where it was until about 3 or 4 days before the invasion took place.
Did they tell you then where you were going in? Or?
Yeah, they told us it would be Omaha Beach, and there in the Normandy coast, and the Utah Beach would be next to us, and the British would be to the left of us. Mm-hmm. And in other words, the 29th Division, which was Private Ryan's division, according to that story. And incidentally, that particular movie, I thought, would depicted the D-Day situation better than most of them that I've seen. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we left Plymouth, England at on LCI, which is a landing craft infantry. We were on the ship several days ahead of time, but they had to delay the invasion because of the weather. We were supposed to go in on the 5th, which would mean we'd leave Plymouth on the 4th, but it was put off a day, and I think a lot of people have seen the delay that took place, and then he said, Eisenhower said, let's go. I mean, the weather was the indication there'd be a little break in the weather, and they could do it on the 6th of June, 1944. So we left Plymouth on the 5th, the evening of the 5th, and went across the channel, and we were went in on D-Day. Our division was the landing at 6:30 in the morning, one regiment, another one at 7:30, but everything got backed up. And I was just reading today about the delay that took place there, and it wasn't until 10 or 11 o'clock where they really had a foothold in that beach. And then our outfit came in around 3 or 4 in the afternoon.
Was it as bad as the movie?
Yeah.
It was that bad,
yeah,
losses and...
It was...
A lot of enemy fire?
A lot of enemy fire, even up until that evening of the 6th. There was a lot of debris in the water. There were bodies in the water. There were tanks in the water. There were all kinds of equipment. And all of us, all the troops that were coming in were carrying extra baggage. Beside our own necessities, we were carrying medical supplies and mortar shells and ammunition and food, what have you, you know, for the invasion. Mm-hmm. That night of the 6th we were in, got up the top of the bluff. That was as far as we got the first night. Mm-hmm. And from then on it was hedgerow fighting all the way to Comont, which was about 21 miles inland. and holding a line, and the Allies were bringing in as much material as they could in the meantime, setting up an airstrip there on the top of the mm-hmm. beachhead, and a hospital, and other things there. While we were, the infantry was moving in, going in about 21 miles mm-hmm. inland. Mm-hmm.
Were the losses, that was that kind of continuous as you were walking,
yeah,
as you were moving
there were,
in?
There were snipers, there was a lot of mortar fire, they had a few counterattacks that were trying to come in and slow it down, but it was, it just seems as though the Germans were disorganized to the point because of the paratroopers that had landed behind the lines to start with, sort of threw them off whack, and they didn't know who was where exactly, you know, and how many. Mm-hmm. And they put a lot of force, it seems as though they put a lot of emphasis on tanks and artillery and men and manpower to fight in the British zone around Caen, that's C-A-E-N, Caen, which they held off the British there for a month. Mm. But it was in July, we got up 21 miles, 22 miles inland, and we were holding the line while a lot of the supplies were coming in, and I was on a patrol one night on 13th of July of 44, and we got behind the German line and got ambushed and got shot along with seven others. And
you got shot?
Yeah, uh-huh. I got shot in both legs. Mm-hmm. But the medics came and got us out of there. Mm-hmm. It was a miracle that I never thought I'd make it. But there were seven of us that they got out. And there were 14 in the thing. But when you're on a patrol, they set up a perimeter. I mean, if there's people that are hurt, there wasn't the Germans didn't attack us anymore because we wiped out that outpost, and there were some flares flying in that, but within a couple of hours the medics were down to get us out of there. Mm-hmm. Then they sent me back to England, and from England I was recuperated, and they decided I was young enough and I could go back to my outfit again, so that's what they were doing. There was a lot of guys with shrapnel and bullet, and I had a bullet in my hip, and they never took it out until I had it taken removed in 1964. Wow. And had it there the whole time. But yeah, then I left England again, came back, joined the outfit, and by that time I was wounded on July 13th of 44. I came back to the to France in September and joined my outfit in the end of September, middle of September. Mm-hmm. The 1st Division was way up into Belgium by that time. Mm-hmm. So that was an experience that I had. And then when we got into Germany with the 1st Division, they reassigned me into regimental headquarters in the S2, which was the intelligence section. And I was asked to participate in offering Aachen, Germany a surrender, to surrender, and we walked into and about another 50 yards ahead, here's a German looking at you, wondering what's going on, you know. But
sure.
Yeah, we were in there about an hour and a half, 2 hours, in mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. presenting them. They didn't, Aachen, Germany was one of the major battles for our outfit anyway, the 1st Division, 1st Army, really. And it took another 10 days after our episode of going in and presenting them with the ultimatum to surrender. Mm-hmm. And it was probably the most outstanding experience that I had during the war, because I had a close contact with the enemy. I was in their possession. And you know, it goes through your mind, you get some SS guy or something in there,
happy guy.
And they say, well, we'll just keep these three guys for ransom, you know.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
But it didn't happen that way.
Yeah. We're going to come back to you. We want to move along. It's quite a story.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Ray Vavra is our next guy up.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, we want to hear what went on. And it can be bad, it can be good, it can be in between. You determine that.
Well, I grew up in the western suburbs and met my wife after coming home from the service, and married her in 1948, so it gives us 54 years of marriage. And we moved out to LaGrange Park in 1952, so we've had enjoyable 50 years here. Actually, I entered the Marine Corps in February of 1943 and went through boot camp in San Diego. And backtracking a little bit, in 1942, the Marine Corps felt as though they wanted to develop some tactical intelligence information from the Japanese that they could get. And in March of 43, the Navy Department authorized platoon strength intelligence groups, six of them, and they were formulated in Camp Elliott, which is outside of San Diego, and that's where I was stationed at the time, and I joined the 3rd Radio and Intelligence Platoon. Actually, most of our radio men were trained up at Bainbridge Island with intercept school Japanese code, and at that time, we formulated in Camp Elliott, and in November we moved over to the island of Oahu and the Hawaiian Islands, and for a while we were attached to the naval radio station there in Waiawa. Waiawa is a little town up in the pineapple fields overlooking Hickam Field, which had its duty during the raid on Pearl Harbor. From there, our group was moved down to the Ennebor in the islands, and there we were assigned to a naval radio station, and at that point they were intercepting Japanese communication, and we were transferring it back to FRUPAC, which was Fleet Radio Unit in the Pacific, back in Pearl Harbor.
Now, did you have to know Japanese, or how did
I happen? Myself know, but our radio men had to, because they studied the Japanese code and were able to take it down, and that was what we transferred back to FRUPAC. And then all of a sudden, I think it was in the fall or these were take the northern. Well, most of the concentration was down south, and at a point later on in the invasion, they asked the Marines to come down and assist the Army with it down south. And from, of course, that was my first exposure to invasion atmosphere. And, of course, the kamikaze planes were something new for me to see dropping down in the bay. But we moved on over to Guam, and at when we were at Guam, that's when the bomb was dropped in Japan, the two bombs. And then we were assigned to northern China for post-war occupational duties. A little town called Tinsin. Well, this part was in the Yellow Sea and just west of Korea. And we motored up We took a train up rather inland to the town of Tinson, and that's where we were from October until February when we headed back home.
Mm-hmm. Very good. We want to ask some questions too, but let's move on to number three, who is Doc, who is really Henry, but he's really better known as Doc Mathews, and he is certainly a medical person. And Doc, tell us about what you did, and your experiences are a little quite different because of the assignments
yes,
that you
yeah,
had.
Yes, yeah, yeah. Well, I graduated from dental school in 1940, and then opened an office to practice dentistry. And in 42, war was declared, so I was drafted in 42, and I had to close the office. But I wasn't ordered to active duty right away because the 18-year-olds didn't wait to be drafted because then you had no choice of where to serve, and they wanted to be a Marine or in the infantry or the Air Force. So they didn't have enough dentists in the regular Army or physicians to make the exams. So we went to the draft board every Tuesday night, and then the volunteers would be there and we'd examine them. And then in a short time, the draft board said that I had to go to active duty now because he was putting my name back in the file as it came up because they didn't have enough dentists in the regular Army drafted already. But then they mm-hmm. did, and I was ordered to active duty. The physicians and dentists were subject to draft to age 54. And so the men had, I was single, but there are men that had families. And your first lieutenant's pay was $166.60 a month. And out of that, you had to buy three meals. They charged a quarter for breakfast, a quarter for lunch, a quarter for supper. So you lost 75 cents out of that. You had to buy your own uniform and your own laundry, things you had to do. Once it was overseas, that was all free. So a captain's salary was a little higher. And I just opened up my office. It wasn't built to make money, and I was in debt on the thing to start out with. So I enjoyed getting that $200 salary at that time, yeah. But then in Camp Landing, we just stayed there long enough, and I think we just were there about 2.5 months. To form the station hospital, we had 8 physicians, 3 dentists, and 48 nurses, 2 Red Cross workers, 2 chaplains, one a Catholic priest, the other a Protestant, and 375 enlisted men. So we're a self-sustained unit, and ambulances, 3 ambulances and drivers for it. So when the unit was all complete, we got orders to go to the Pacific Theater, and on a train, we left Florida on a train, spent 4 days going to Sacramento or San Francisco, I guess. We got off there, and we were just there like a day and a half because they were loading, and it was a Dutch ship in the parlor there, and we were loading, and we got on, the whole unit got on. We left the Dutch ship going strictly south right away in a convoy, and for about 3 days, and then we were on our own. Then we zigzagged when you traveled, and you went that way, that way. And the idea was that submarines, see, Japan had control of the Pacific Ocean, and that a submarine would see that if they would fire the torpedo that way, but when you made the turn, they got missed. Mm-hmm. You had a 50-50 chance of not getting hit. The Japs were smart enough, they didn't fire the submarine that way. They did when you're this way, then you turned into it. But we didn't get hit at all. But we ended up then in Milne Bay, Townsville, Australia. And the reason they had to go there was because of the water and more food got on there. We didn't even get off the ship. And then we were there maybe like 12 hours. And then we went to Milne Bay and set up the hospital there in the Australian coconut plantation. And our first patients, or the wounded, was from the Solomon Islands, see. Mm-hmm. And I was the oral surgeon in the unit, and but took care of the face wounds, and most of my work really was I took out the machine gun bullets out of their legs. Mm-hmm. See, when you the beaches would be bombed by a cannon fire, and then you had dunes, you know, holes in there. The Marines crawled on their belly to get hid behind it. They got up close enough, then they were in the machine gun fire. The Japs had retreated like from the bombing, see, into the forest and camouflaged the machine gun nest so you wouldn't even know that. So the Marines then were, just when they walked over through there, they, the whole mess of them got shot right away. And wounded very heavy, and then they realized what was happening. So then they would set up a one man in the middle, and you know, made 20, 30 yards to the right and left. Then you made on a signal. Then the guy, the Marine, held up his helmet on the gun, made noise, and of course the Jap fired it. And then you had to look to see, so they had an idea where this was. Then they had a signal. Then when you did that, then you jumped up out of this hole you were in and threw the grenade, and you tried to get it actually in the machine gun, so if you could, or at least near it. And then the other troops would run over there and stab them. No prisoners taken. You had to kill the Japanese. Yeah, we had no facilities for them anyway. Then they were brought back to the hospital. And of course, when they got up and threw the grenade, you slip sometimes in the sand. You can't throw it far. And if they did, and the Japs then caught onto it, so then they swayed the machine gun when they heard it from the, and then when you threw the grenade, you jumped back behind your hole, but your legs would be up, and so you got shot in the legs. See? And I took out a lot of bullets. From the, I would wrap them up in the in gauze, you know, and tie it on their dog tags because they like. I think they liked, enjoyed that in there.
It was interesting because you talked about going to Milne Bay, I was there a little later than you, and I really wish that I went to one of the dentists in New Guinea, and he suggested that I should have four of my teeth taken out in the back.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was better than in the front, but it, you know, in the back. And so I said to him, "Well, is it really necessary?" And he said, "Well, so I suppose I could fill them."
Mm-hmm. Well,
now you wouldn't do that, Doc. I know.
Yeah.
But anyhow, this. So he did fill them, and he put gold in there. And I had until quite recently, I had some gold in.
Wonderful, yeah. It's expensive.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's the Army. We don't care about such things.
See, Doctor, you have to look at it this way. In the military, you got paid for what you did.
Yeah.
And now, if he would have extracted those teeth, fine. You know, that would be one appointment, and he'd take them out maybe 25 minutes, sew them up, a half an hour for the whole appointment, see. But when he filled them, now he had to clean out the caries. Probably they were deep, and the pulp would be exposed. So then he had to do a root fill, and then build in the crown is all wasted. Right. Yeah. Then he had to put a post in this, see, and then build the crown around it and cast it, like four or five appointments. One, see, and you got paid the same, not five times as much.
Okay, we'll get back to some of your stuff too, Doc. Our last but certainly not least presenter is Ralph Wakerly, and you had some experiences like all of us, I think.
Yes,
and
I did.
We'd like to hear about those.
I was one of these guys that was stupid enough to enlist on my own. Actually, I loved aviation. I loved the idea of flying a plane. I remember Lindbergh when he landed in Chicago. I actually saw him at the lakefront there when he circled in the spirit of St. Louis. Later I saw Italo Balbo, whom Balbo Drive is named after. He brought a fleet of seaplanes over and landed in the lake and taxied them up on the tarmac there at the lakefront. And I saw the Graf Zeppelins and the Akron and the Macon Zeppelins. So I loved aviation. So the thought of flying was always great to me. However, I knew I wouldn't be able to get it because my eyesight, I had astigmatism and nearsightedness. But at any rate, I wanted to be around planes, so I enlisted in 1939. I had 1 year at Wilson Junior College in Chicago, pre-engineering courses. Five months at the Aeronautical University, which was a trade school converted to training mechanics, and that was at 1338 South Michigan Boulevard, probably still there as a trade school, and spent 5 months there, got out of there, went back to Selfridge Field, and was assigned to the 40th Pursuit Squadron. At that time, we had real modern planes. We had Sikorsky P-35s, which were the forerunner of the Thunderbolts, the P-47s, believe it or not. And also I was a crew chief eventually, had an AT-6 that I used to have to push into the hangar at night after the guys had taken it out. It was just a two-seater advanced trainer. And I remember the one guy would take it to Washington over the weekend and throw his golf clubs in the back cockpit and take the plane, gone. When he came back, I helped him unload, and then I had to push that plane into the hangar. And this is Selfridge Field, Michigan, the weather's like Chicago. And it was pretty hard to push a plane when you had slick ice on the ground. But I'd get under the tail section and lift it with my shoulders and push it back that way. You know, I just kind of nudge it and get it into the hangar. After a while, the Air Corps at the time I enlisted was only 18,000 people. By the time I was discharged, it was over 1 million people. So it was in the process of expanding. We were put into the 10th Pursuit Squadron. Some of my buddies that had gone to technical school with me were assigned to the 1st Pursuit Group, which contained the 94th Pursuit Squadron, which was the Lafayette Escadrille in World War I, Eddie Rickenbacker's outfit. The hat and the ring was their insignia on the plane. Many of them went overseas before I did. They went to various theaters, and I was subsequently sent to Key Field in Meridian, Mississippi. We were the only pursuit squadron in the South at that time. And was there for a few months, and then we went from there over to Orlando, Florida, and we formed the Night Fighter Squadrons. Night Fighter Squadrons were started in night fighter planes in England, where they used radar to help the pilot locate enemy aircraft. He'd carry a radar observer with him who would direct the pilot to the target until he got visual contact. And at that time, of course, the pilot would take over and try to shoot him down. Or they could be used on ground targets as well. So we pioneered that at Orlando in this country using A-20s, which were called P-70 night fighters. They had a big spinner up in the nose that was silver, and it was in a plastic clear canopy, and the people were wondering, what is that? They'd see this thing reflecting when they'd fly over. So they painted it all black, so they were all black after that. And from there, in 43, I had an unfortunate episode where I crashed along with two other guys, and it was at Kissimmee in Lake Tehopakaliga, and I was just about killed. The other two guys did not make it, and I spent 130 days in the Orlando Air Base Hospital recovering. I had to fight my way to get out of there. I wanted to get back to the outfit. Got back to the outfit, which was in Kissimmee, Florida at this time, and subsequently I was sent to California along with the outfit a year after my crash. They put me, they said, do you want to fly out or do you want to ride the train to California? And I said, I better fly. If I don't fly now, I'll never fly again. You know, I'd be afraid of flying. So they gave me a plane that I was a crew chief on. It had the same number on the tail, exactly 64. And I said, oh, this is something, you know. And we left the same day that I crashed the year before. And we had a couple of episodes going over there. Got stalled over in Meridian, Mississippi, where one of the valves had broken off in the engine. We had to do an engine change there. And the rest of the group went on. My good buddy came up to me. He says, well, Wake, he says, my nickname was Wake at the time. He said, I guess it's goodbye for sure this time. Because on that first flight that I crashed in, we had the crews had changed two engines, and the guy wanted somebody to go along to ride with him on a test flight. So I said, I'll go. It was a Saturday. I didn't mind. And he lost an engine, tried to make a one-engine landing, missed his approach, and decided to go around again. And that's a fatal error. If you're coming in on one engine, bring it down, belly it in, do anything you want. But he made a banking approach and decided to go around again. I was just looking out the back canopy at the time. And he started coming up, and I'm looking out, and he pulls the damn gear up, which is fine to reduce drag, but then he pulls the flaps up all the way. And we got into a mush, and he's trying to climb and on one engine with that throttle wide open, and we were yawing along like that, and we got out about a mile and a half, and pew, we just dropped. And I don't remember the fall. I think my head hit the canopy. So that was that. At any rate, we were shipped at that time. A year later, we went out to Fresno, California at Hammer Field, and I was sent to night fighter school in Hawthorne, California, where they made the P-61 Black Widow night fighter, which was a brand new fighter which was commissioned. I went to school on that and got an excellent rating and came back to Fresno. And what did they do? In the usual inefficient ways, they had decided to clean out everybody that had not been overseas and throw them into an overseas replacement depot. So I was thrown in an overseas group, not as a night fighter, but just overseas. They shipped us off to Greensboro. Got the training with the carbines and all that, back up to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, and shipped overseas on the Queen Elizabeth. We were boarding the Queen Elizabeth, going up the gangplank from a building inside, and we saw these British guys standing around, the sailors, by the gangplank. And one of our guys says, hi, mate, what tub is this? And the English guy is real incensed about this. He says, I'll have you know this ain't no tub, your matey. He says, this is Her Majesty's Queen Elizabeth. Oh, and that's how we found out where we're getting on. I was on about G deck, which was several decks above the water yet. And unfortunately, the colored troops were below the waterline at that time. And we took 6 days. It had to go out at a certain time of day, and it had to dock at a certain time. So we went up to the Firth of Clyde in Scotland, where we docked. And then we took a train over to Edinburgh, which was east, and then south into England. And we stayed at the a little base in Metfield, England. It's near the White Cliffs of Dover. It's the town was Metfield, and the base there had a little mission going on. We were not part of it because I was assigned to the Air Transport Command. And the colonel that brought us in, a very famous gentleman named Bernt Balchen, had been a Norwegian explorer with Admiral Byrd. And he said, when you fellas see something going on around here, he said, don't tell anybody what it is if you find out. But they were ferrying our interned airmen back from Europe, where they were interned in neutral countries. And they'd fly these black unmarked Liberators over at night, land, pick up the guys, bring them back to our base, and then they'd be gone. They'd fly them back to the US and use them in the Pacific. So that was called Secret Squadron X, and it never came out until after the war, what they were doing.
It's amazing how much went on that the public didn't know about. Yeah. Americans didn't know about a lot of things.
I was only there one short time, and they shipped us west then all the way to Cornwall province, and the town was Newquay, N-E-W-Q-U-A-Y. It's a really a beautiful resort town, you know. It's got the rocks and the cliffs and very picture and the beaches and everything like that. And the base was St. Morgan's, M-A-W-G-A-N-S. It's still in existence. And there was where our flights would come in from the U.S. in the wintertime. In the summertime, when the weather was mild, they'd come up in Prestwick, Scotland. So there were two air transport bases. So from there, we took off and we went to southern France, and I got there. The Germans had been out of the place by then, and I was down around Marseille. I was staying in a little villa with French pinup gals on the wall. The Germans had their own pinup gals, that's what it was. And our little air base was nearby, and we serviced anything that came in. The hangars had been partially blasted out of the place, and we just worked out of there. And mainly it was C-47s, which is the workhorse of the transport business. Well, we serviced everything that came through, and I saw the war. The Secretary of War Stimson at the time, I believe it was, and they had gone on in a smaller plane to Frankfurt for this peace conference that they were attending. The crew, however, was left behind. The pilots had gone. Some of the crew guys were there, and so I got on board, and here's a guy with a rifle slung over his shoulder drinking, you know, everybody's drinkings. And the guy is telling me, he says, we got 23 cases of Red Feather whiskey. They stole five of us from us in Casablanca. They had come up from Casablanca for their first meeting, and so we're having a little party at night, you know. I had to dispose of all the wreckage in the morning. The guy said, what are we going to do with all these bottles and stuff? I says, I'll get a Jeep. So I got a Jeep, threw it in there, brought it down to the abandoned hangar and dumped the stuff, and that was it. So what did I see during the war? Well, I got over to Nice. We flew some nurses over that came over. Our highest ranking officer on that base was a major, and he had to greet all these generals and stuff coming down the gangplank. It was amazing. But when that war ended, the guys came out and said, okay, boys, chalk them up, block them up, block them up, and take off. Mm-hmm. There was dancing in the streets. Yeah. So then we went up, and I was sent up to Orly Field, where De Gaulle was, and continued working all through the summer. And when the war ended there, I used to go in on the shuttle bus to Paris. We had a nightclub up in the Eiffel Tower on that first level that was really something. They had those elevators that ran up on the legs, and they ran up kind of an angle, you know, and there were huge elevators. And we go up there, and here they had a swing band, a French swing band in there, you know, don't fence me in. It was amazing to hear those guys, you know, and they always had a funny beat to them, the French orchestras. But we enjoyed it, so met a lot of people there. So I didn't have the hardships that you did, Ken, or you did in the Pacific. I had my suffering in the hospital. But I made it through okay. And oddly enough, I went back home. They established, when the war ended up at Orly Field, you know, I was at Orly Field. They sent us to Le Havre about a month or so later, and it was November, maybe more than a month later. He had to go out on points, and I just had 69 points, and he needed 70. We called ourselves the 69 Club. And finally, they altered the rules so that if you're over part of a month, they give you the 2 points for that month. Prior to that, you get 1 point for a domestic party or 2 points for every month you're overseas. So I had just 69, and that gave me 70, so I was eligible to go home.
Yeah, that point system was interesting.
Yeah.
Because if you didn't have the points, then something else was going to happen.
Yeah.
I was in our outfit was in the Philippines at the time the war in the Pacific ended, but I didn't have enough points, and so guess what? I go up to Japan.
And that would have been bad stuff.
Well, you know, it wasn't too bad actually up there, and You needed that kind of stuff. They needed people to, although actually the Japanese after the war were just incredible. Mm-hmm. They accepted everything.
MacArthur was very smart because he got the alliance with the emperor.
He
ruled it through the emperor.
Sure.
Hirohito.
And the emperor
Hirohito
said, "Hey, you cooperate with these folks."
They're very obedient.
And we were in Japan. And the first 30 days of being at this one city, one town, there were some 300 cases of crime involving GIs and civilians. Every one of those was instituted, it was started up by GIs.
Yeah.
It was just absolutely incredible.
Far worse.
We had, we were in a Mitsubishi aircraft facility, and there was a track running parallel to that. And we were outside, and we saw this GI walking over, and he got on the track. And we thought that maybe this was going to be
a suicide
kind of thing.
Sounds like.
Well, he stands up there. The train is coming at him. He puts his hand up like this. The train stops. The door opens, and the Japanese conductor, you know, makes the gestures. He can come on. He can, you know, no money. You know, just come on. And that was, it was just absolutely incredible the way they responded. And I remember saying to some of my buddies, what if we had lost? And the Japanese are over there. Those Japanese would be shot from behind bushes, trees, cars, houses, whatever. It would be an awful thing. Mm-hmm. But the Japanese, that the emperor said, it's over. Yeah. And this very, very disciplined people said, it's over.
They still are.
And they still are.
To finish my little story,
I
wanted to tell you one thing. They established all these camps of debarkation, and they were named after cigarette companies. They had Chesterfield, Lucky Strike, Camels, and so on. And at Lee Harb, they had a number of these camps. So I went to Camp Wings, because I was in the Air Corps. And from there, we were sweating out a ship, you know. Want to go home. And they posted on the board every day. So finally, one day, the guy comes over. We got it. We made it. I says, what is it? What's the ship? He says, the Twickenham Ferry. We go to Southampton now. And that's what we took. The Twickenham Ferry, they didn't even know we were coming. We crossed the English Channel. It was bobbing like a cork. Two-thirds of the guys got seasick. We were on that thing about 8 hours. And finally, they shipped us up to a little barracks in Tidworth, England, and stayed there for another couple of weeks, sweating out a ship to take us home. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, what do we get? We got the Queen Mary. So I had the honor of riding two Queen ships, boarded that thing a year, just about a year later. I was about a year overseas. I went over on November 11th to the 27th, and I came back on the same dates the following year, with the 22nd to the 27th. So I was on both Queen ships. And the same, I got off the gangplank, and I swear it was the same lady gave me a donut, you know. they had a dock at the same dock, and the lady was passing out donuts.
Guys, what I'd like to do now is draw out from you, I think we'll just go around the same way, some things that, events, we've talked kind of generally what's happened to us, but for example, what was the most tragic event that you experienced or you witnessed while you were in the service during the war?
Probably the Battle of the Bulge, and the that was a after Aachen and Hurtgen Forest, we went down to the Battle of the Bulge, and the tragedy of Malmedy, where the German SS had killed something like 30 to 60 American. Rounded them up right in a field and killed them.
Just slaughtered them.
Yeah. And all German troops were not that way.
Yeah.
I mean, I ran enough into enough of them personally to know that they were good soldiers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's go.
Well, as you just mentioned a moment ago up there in Japan about the situation with the situations being instigated by the GIs. When we were in the southern part of Okinawa, we had this Nisi with us, Naki, he was an interpreter, and one day, all of a sudden, a woman had broken through the lines. She was with the Japanese, and the Japanese told her that the American are rapists, and they are not, they're cruel. Mm-hmm. Well, lo and behold, she tries to break through the lines, and what happens but two GIs try to rape her.
Oh, God.
And, of course, this is exactly what they told the women
sure,
there.
Sure.
And she saw this interpreter that we had, and she just ran, and she was so frightened that she just grabbed him and mm-hmm. hugged him and held on to him.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. It was sort of tragic to see something like that happen.
Yeah, yeah.
Behavior.
For sure. Doc, how about
yeah,
you?
This happened in Leyte, the Allan attack Loban, I think, was there. We left from Milne Bay, set up the hospital there. I'd been promoted to major in the meantime, and I was taking care of a soldier. He was shot in the face, and his cheek was ripped out, and the mandible was splintered up. And I was wiring his mandible mm-hmm. together, and I tap on my shoulder, and I look up, and it's the colonel. And he says, "Major, the soldier is dead." But he said, "We got another shipment of wounded in." He says, "Can you fill out the Purple Heart form for him?" I said, "Yes, sir, I can." See, but I couldn't leave him that way. I finished setting up his jaw,
yeah.
and his cheek rip. I put it all in there, put the muscle back, and sewed it up real nice. So just a nice little slit. It looked nice. It's just impossible
yeah.
To do something like.
Hmm.
But that was the only post-home, form that I filled out,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Ralph, how about you?
I could tell you an amusing thing or something of that sort.
Well,
I
hold
already
on
told
to that.
You.
If you got some, some tragic
thing. You want something tragic?
Sir. Sad.
I crashed.
Yeah, that's
that was
that's tragic. Pretty. That's pretty.
Yeah,
sad.
Two guys were killed in that,
oh,
and I saw some others, of course.
In a year in the hospital.
I was about 131 days, nearly
yeah,
5 months.
And that's a stretch.
Yeah, it was a stretch. We had others that crashed too, of course,
uh-huh.
and we were losing the plane a week there for a while. And that was when I was at Kissimmee, and it seemed to happen on Friday afternoons. But what else can I tell you? Sad events. I was fortunate in that I wasn't in the heat of battle like you gentlemen were. By the time I got to Europe, the war had been taken over by us. I saw the 1,000-plane raids going out.
Sure.
From where I was in England, and you could see them coming back in the afternoon shooting out the flares, either orange flares or red,
mm-hmm.
determining if they had wounded on board and things of that sort. So I was very fortunate that way.
Mm-hmm. All right, how about let's go to laughter, things that were funny, that lightened up our experience while we were in the service?
Yeah, the instance that I can remember was induction at Camp Grant, and we were getting inoculated, and as we were coming up, and the guy in front of me, his name was Kelly, big strapping Irish boy, you know, nothing to scare him, it's all muscle and everything, you know, and he gets up there. We went through this Quonset hut, and not a Quonset hut, but a barracks where you line up and you go through and you get a shot in each arm. And he passed out as cold as, of all the guys you'd never think would do it, he was dead on the floor right there. Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. Well, let me kind of, some funny things that went on, I think, that I experienced too. One of them that kind of stayed with me because it, as you'll appreciate, one of the questions that they asked me, and I'm sure everybody were asked the same question, was, "Do you like girls?" Now you can wonder about where this fits into the military thrust, you know. But anyhow, I said with a certain amount of enthusiasm that I like girls very much. And that was it, you see. Now, had I said something else, you see, then I would have been I probably would not have been in service at all and passed over. But you know, those are some of the kind of funny things that do go on.
when we were on occupational duty in northern China in the winter of 1945 into 46, Chiang Kai-shek was in power at the time, and the communists were out in the foothills. And Madam Chiang Kai-shek was sponsoring 2 and 3 day groups, tours into Peking, now known as Beijing. And another fellow and I were selected out of our group to go, and we went over the holidays. And I can remember that while I was there, I had my one and only shave at a Chinese barbershop. Because I thought when I came out of that barbershop, my skin was off my face.
Really,
and
fine,
I hit
huh?
that cold China air, and I can remember that quite well.
Good. Doc, how about you? There had to be some funny ones come along.
The happiest one for me it is we had left Manila with the hospital from. Lady, you know, we went to Luzon, said that was her, and we didn't know where we were going because they don't give out the orders for secret. We were on board a ship, and I was sitting at the fantail and playing bridge with a couple of nurses. I don't remember getting any good cards, by the way, but anyway, I noticed the wake, and it's a U-turn. So I told the nurse lady, look, what's happened? We're going, where we were going, we're going back again, see? And so everyone was just surprised, and a few minutes later, the voice. Hear this, this is the captain speaking. I know when you, that's they do it. He said, the war is over. A bomb was dropped at Nagasaki and Hiroshima, and the emperor gave up, surrendered. And we just shot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course, then he said, and the order says that you were slated to set up the hospital D2 in Tokyo. But because of that, he said, that's why we made the turn. We have been ordered to go to Seoul, Korea. And that's where we set up the hospital there then.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay, and Ralph.
Just a little tiny story about a guy down in Florida. He was always goofing up, you know. He never could do things right. He was always making mistakes and so on. So as a result, he was a private. And had quite a stretch in service. He had over a hitch in, you know, which was entitled him to a stripe on his sleeve. So the new squadron commander, he knew the guy's name, but he didn't know much about him. So he was at inspection this one day and coming along the line, looking everybody over, and he says, BK, he says, how long, he says, you're only a private. He said, how long you been in this army? He says, 4 years, sir. He says, 4 years? You're in the Army and you're a private, why? And BK says, well, sir, he says, I reckon it's because they ain't got anything less.
That was it. Good answer.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see, I think we got maybe time to get to, let's see, what should we do? Maybe about, we've talked a little bit about Native people. Any stories that you'd like to share with our viewers about Native people, good, bad, or indifferent?
Well, not really. I mean, it was when you're in an infantry outfit and you're moving around, you don't make too much contact except where non-fraternization at the end of the war and during the time we were traveling through Germany especially was a rather difficult for some because the Germans, a lot of them in the rural areas, were prone to be like the Americans and were very friendly to them, you know, not mainly in the rural areas.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't actually see a lot of civilians or what you would call Native French or Germans or anything, but it seemed that they were all hiding most of the time.
Yeah. Let me tell you one fast one. We just have a couple of more minutes. At one time, I was given a number of Filipino people. We were a combat outfit, but being engineers, we also built things. And so when we were not fighting, we were building. And we were putting up cement floors and then really barracks, in a sense. And I had this Filipino group with me, and so I divided them up. I think there were about 12. I had six over here and six over there. And about two or three minutes over, I look and I see nine over here and three over here. Well, I went over and I, you know, kind of went through the thing again, over here. And, you know, do something else. And I looked up and here again, there's nine over here and three over here. Well, then the lieutenant came by and I told him, you know, the problem. And he said, well, you know, just move in on them and tell them what to do. Well, one of the Filipino guys explained to me that nine of these people came from one region, they spoke differently, and they had a different religion, you see. The other three didn't. And so what I did is divided the nine or the ten of them up, and then I had the other guys just kind of fiddle around, you know. But those kind of things, you know, this cultural stuff
tend to cluster.
It is really, really that, yeah.
Exactly.
Ethnicity.
Well, I think our time is just about coming. They're waving at me. So, gentlemen, we thank you for being here, and your stories have been interesting, as I knew they would be. And
well, thank you for being our moderator.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Good.
Are we off?